itself, yeah. And I think this is so interesting because when you think of Isambard Kingdom Brunel, you think of a sort of a brash Victorian, riding trains, building bridges.
Confidence, oozing confidence.
Confidence, cigar in his mouth, you know, hat on, standing in front of these chains. This is a 22-year-old who is worried. He's worried about what's going to happen to him in the future.
This feels very intimate, being here so close to these pages, handwritten by Brunel himself.
The accident in the Thames Tunnel had clearly taken a mental toll on the young Brunel. But he also had to cope with the physical scars.
His injuries were so bad, Brunel was advised to leave London and his tunnel far behind. He agreed and came here, to Bristol. But once he'd arrived, there was to be little time for rest and recuperation.
Brunel formed a bond with the city that survives to this day. His first solo engineering challenge was to produce an iconic work that remains one of Britain's most instantly recognised symbols. The Clifton Suspension Bridge. It remains one of Brunel's greatest legacies. Renowned the world over, it's one of the engineering marvels that made his name. Spanning a breathtaking 200 metres across and standing 75 metres above the River Avon, it's a stunning sight. Brunel arrived in Bristol in 1829, just as the city fathers announced a competition to find an engineer to design a bridge across the Avon Gorge. Young, brash and audacious, Brunel threw his hat into the ring. But he had to work fast.
Astonishingly, in just 7 weeks, Brunel, who'd never worked on a bridge before, came up with four separate designs. They were all for suspension bridges, ranging from 760 feet to a staggering 1,180 feet.
Thomas Telford, the renowned engineer who designed and built the Menai Bridge in Wales, was appointed judge of the competition. 22 designs were submitted in total, but Telford rejected them all.
Telford claimed that Brunel's designs would collapse in a strong wind and that it was impossible to build a suspension bridge longer than 600 feet. Funnily enough, that was about the length of Telford's own suspension bridge across the Menai Strait in North Wales.
Telford was eventually asked to submit his own design, but it met with huge disapproval from the people of Bristol. So a second competition was launched, and a familiar entrant came forward.
Brunel cleverly rethought the plans for his bridge, so the span would now be 630 feet across. With an eye for detail that would become one of his trademarks, he designed the towers in a striking Egyptian style. He even intended a sphinx to be sat atop each of the towers.
Brunel's plans were warmly received, and he was finally chosen as the winner. But designing the bridge was only half the battle. Now he had to actually build it. It would be the longest and highest ever seen.
Construction of his Clifton Suspension Bridge finally began on the 27th of August, 1831. But it was a project fraught with problems. 4 months in, the entire operation came to a halt.
The reason? Money. The financial backers for the bridge simply ran out. With the Thames Tunnel project and now the Clifton Suspension Bridge both stalled, Brunel's grand ambitions were being frustrated. Fortuitously, at the same time, a new and revolutionary form of transport was on the horizon. The railways were coming. And it's hard to overestimate what an impact they would have on the nation and the world. Brunel was excited. It gripped his imagination, and he was desperate to get involved. The Liverpool and Manchester Railway, built by Brunel's friend and rival Robert Stephenson, was the world's first major rail passenger service.
Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell.
75 metres above the River Avon, it's a stunning sight.